Hello guys, this is PanzerMice36 and welcome to my full weathering tutorial on this Dragon StuG III F8 in 1/35th scale. Yes, this video is quite long, but it is a full in-depth tutorial where I demonstrate and explain each step in my usual weathering process. I also go over all the products that I use for each effect, show how I create the effect and explain why I'm doing the effect to replicate how the tank will be weathered in real life. If you're not here for the full video and are only interested in a certain effect, such as applying a wash and filter, and I have provided the timestamps in the video description below to each sub-step in the weathering process. I've also linked relevant videos in the cards above, which will be to other tutorials that I have done in the past, which offer more information or alternate techniques for achieving similar weathering effects. Now, of course, this is my weathering process. You don't need to do everything the same way that I do it, or use the exact same products that I do. You can use these same techniques on a tank that isn't whitewashed, or on a other camouflage color, for example. This video is meant to be more of an inspiration than a guide, as you may modify my methods however you'd like if you're aiming for other results of more your style. If you have any questions about this video, or would like to let me know how I can improve upon videos like this in the future, then please post in the comments below, I always read them all. Before we begin, I would like to give a few shoutouts to a couple of fellow YouTubers. Firstly, to Adam Mann for sending me this kit in the first place and for helping me with the tool colors and for his advice in creating this video. I would also like to thank Steve Gibson for all the reference photos and for the StuG book that he sent me, which greatly helped in all the little touches I added while building and weathering this tank. Thank you all for watching, and I do hope you enjoy this video and find it helpful and inspirational. Let's start the weathering process. Right now, our StuG looks pretty great, but to begin, it did look a lot more boring. To begin, our StuG has merely been base coated in a simple dark yellow color that was standard of most German tanks of this era, 1943. The only thing I've done so far really is paint the interior, which I didn't cover in the video because I just kind of wanted to work out a little bit on my own before I did the video. It was all doing the techniques I showed in the video though, which are just like basic streaking with some oils and a little bit of chipping. Nothing too fancy in there, just really detailed painting and weathering a little bit. Let's take a quick look at all the products I've used so far to get the tank to level it is right now. Since the kit had a decent amount of photo etched parts that I had added and also came with the kit, I gave it a coat of Tamiya Fine Surface Primer before I did the base coat. I gave a uniform color and nice texture for the paint to grip onto. The base coat was a 50-50 mix of Tamiya XF60 and XF14, which gave a slightly lighter, kind of almost Africa Core color, which is kind of typical of this tank. As you can see, the lower hull actually has a gradient. It's a kind of dark green color. That was really just to start the mud effect early, because it was going to be heavy mud effect on this tank. It was a mix of a bunch of colors, basically just like beige, green, brown, a couple of drops of black and red in there. It was kind of convoluted, but you could just pick a standard dark green and just add a little bit of black to it. It'll be fine. Of course, all my Tamiya paints are airbrushed using lacquer thinner to thin them down, because I find that makes them airbrushed much smoother than water or X20. And the wheels have been painted with AK704 Dunkel Grau, which is just a really dark gray color. To begin, our StuG needs some markings to make it a uniquely German tank. This will be unit markings and some German crosses. These Dragon kits always come with really nice cartograph decals, which I've never had any issue with, even though I apply them over a just kind of satin paint color. I don't use any gloss coats or anything like that. But I actually wanted to try out these German paint masks from DN Models. These are two-piece masks, so I use these for the German crosses instead of the decals in the kit. The masks come on a nice little sticky sheet here, which I just, you know, pulled them off of. The middle cross part there is not really useful, so I discarded it. Kept the outside mask piece, and I carefully put that on the model. It wasn't too hard to get them straight. I found that if you got one corner stuck on and you could kind of rotate the rest before you pushed it on, that really helped. And here I actually use a Q-tip to roll it on. Not a good idea because little bits of the Q-tip stuck on the model. Here I'm applying some normal painter's masking tape around the side of the mask here just to cover up the outside of the tank. You can use Tamiya tape or anything like that, I just have this on hand. The sheets are a lot bigger so you can just cover a lot more area quicker. And I did a little bit of a crap job there masking it, but it was okay in the end. So I painted the black area of the cross with some Tamiya XF69 Nano Black. It's a little bit lighter than pure black, so I think it's nice. And then the next step was to apply the second part of the mask, which is for the white. and it was a little tricky to get these lined up exactly on the black area, but went to a couple minutes. It was pretty easy. And then now I'm pushing it off my thumb because I learned my lesson from the Q-tip before. The white part of the cross was painted with Tamiya XF2 flat white. And removing the masks, you can see how they do have a really nice effect. If you excuse my crappy masking and a little bit of overspray on the top there, that was just touched up later with a little bit of paint. But they look really realistic. They look like they've been painted on by hand or masked and sprayed on by the crew. I really like how they look. So if you can get your hands on any masks, I would recommend you try it because these look awesome. And they're perfectly flat so you don't have any film issues like you do with decals. Speaking of decals, let's add the unit markings to the tank. If I had masks for these, I sure would try, but it's a pretty complicated little symbol there, so I had to go with the kit decals. So here I'm cutting them from the piece of decal paper with a pair of scissors. Some people might use a knife here. I find scissors have more control, and you don't really slip with a pair of scissors like you can with a knife. And I separate them into individual decals because I'm only going to do one at once here. So I grab them with a pair of pliers carefully and stick them in a little cup of water. Lukewarm water, nothing fancy right now. And we start the process on the tank by applying a little bit of Microsol over the surface where the decal will be applied. Now Microsol is meant to be applied before the decal and Microset after it, but I use Microsol for both and it works perfectly fine. To test the decal if it's ready, I just poke at it a little bit and see if it moves off the paper. It's probably been in here for about a minute and a half at most, so that's usually about a good time frame, a minute to a minute and a half. So I take it out carefully with my pliers, and we just kind of stick it on the model. These decals have really nice working times, so I can line it up, be a little rough with it, it's okay. So I put it on here, and I look, and I think actually it looks pretty straight, so didn't have to move around much. Then here I'm applying a little more Microsol with a damp brush over top of the decal, and then I let it sit for a while. Microsol will help it adhere to the surface. It really softens up the decals so it sits on. On the back here I did the same process, a little bit of Microsol, then I put the decal on and straighten it up, and then I just apply a little more Microsol afterwards. So now our StuG has its markings applied and it looks pretty ready for battle. Let's begin with the weathering process. The first step will be to apply a filter to the tank. Here I'm using Wilder's Dark Tan filter, which is a slightly more golden, dark yellow color than the base color, so it'll add a little bit of warmth to the color of the tank. As an enamel product, this needs to be heavily mixed and then shaken to get the pigments all mixed up with the thinner of the product, so I've sped up a little here, you can see you really have to mix this up. Then I gave it a good shake and started applying it over the model. Now I'm asked this a lot. The difference between a filter and a wash is that a wash is only supposed to be applied around details, while a filter is usually applied over all surfaces of the model. The filter is kind of like a tint or something like that. It really just modifies the base color of the tank. You can apply a filter like this, which is slightly darker, to give the tank a little bit of warmth. Or you can apply a lighter filter to add a little bit of a faded effect, or you can apply a filter of the base color to a tank with some camouflage, and that'll kind of tone down the camouflage colors and really unify them with the base color of the tank. I always try to apply it in a downwards motion like that, just so that if any buildup remains in the tank, at worst you're going to get some very faint streaking effects that kind of simulate rain streaks and stuff like that. But really I'm trying to keep it pretty thin, not letting it build up anywhere, because I don't want any awkward blobby pinwash like accumulations of the filter anywhere. If I do have those spots afterwards, I clean them up later. I show that in a minute here. But really I'm just trying to blend this over the whole tank as a thin tint to the base color. It's a little hard to tell on camera, but hopefully you can see that the base color has been modified slightly. It looks a little more warm, just a little more interesting. I think it has a nice effect. Now we're going to do a pin wash, and for that I'm going to use the Wilder Deep Shadow Wash, which is nice, but it's pretty dark, so I'm lighting up a little bit since the base color is pretty light on the tank. so mixing about half and half with the Wilder Dark Tan filter I previously used. I use a paintbrush as a pouring guide here just so I don't make a mess, and then I'm applying about a 50-50 mix, as I said. Not exact though, just until it's a nice mid-brown color. I'm pouring it into a palette here. The palette is covered in aluminum foil just so it's easier to wash, because I can actually just throw the tin foil rather than having to actually scrub off the palette itself. Now we're going to apply this over all the details in the tank, mainly focusing around areas like rivets, the points where panels meet at 90 degree angles, and also weld seams. I'm being careful not to be too heavy here because I don't want too much, otherwise you get these things called tide marks where you get a really big accumulation of paint and it leaves an awkward ring around the actual rivet instead of a little bit of paint around the rivet. So I'm just applying little bits here and kind of moving it around until it's a very thin but still obviously visible effect. Pin wash is really meant to be applied only around details because it adds some fake shadow effects to the tank, as opposed to a filter which is applied over all the surfaces. Of course, there are different methods for applying a wash, one of which is to apply it over the entire tank and then use some thinner to wipe it away from the flat surfaces, leaving it only around the details. But I find this method, which is called a pin wash, is much faster and easier and uses less product. So here again, I'm only just applying it around the areas where there's details. So here I just wipe it away from the flat surfaces, leaving only in the rivets and weld seams. With the wash and filter now dry, we gotta do a couple of touch-ups to some areas where we don't like how it's accumulated on the model. So I get a little bit of enamel thinner on my brush and lightly rub away areas where we don't like how it's built up on the tank. A good example is in the rear here. You can see the filter didn't dry nicely, so I blend away the spot on the bottom where it built up, and then a couple of downward streaking motions like this really blends it together. With the wash and filter now dry, you can see how it's had a nice effect on the tank. It looks much more realistic and the details are more visible. The next step is going to be to apply some oil rendering to the tank. This is a quite an advanced technique and requires lots of time and patience. I'm using an old brush here that's been used quite a bit. It's quite dead already, it's going to definitely be killed during this process. But it's just a cheap, small, soft bristled brush. I'm using the Wilder colors, light buff, dark yellow, and brown shadow here. If you don't have access to the Wilder colors, the closest standard artist oil colors I can come up with are Naples Yellow, Yellow Ochre, and Raw Umber. And as a brand, the best artist oil brand I find for modeling is Winsor & Newton, but I find that Wilder oils behave better on the plastic surface of a model. So I have a paper towel here that I folded over a couple times, and this is to apply the oil paints to. The Wilder oils do have a little bit of linseed oil in them at the top. I think it's linseed oil at least. But basically you just pour them out like this. The first bit that comes out is going to be oil, you don't want this. Just keep doing this until you actually get the paint coming out right there. Then I apply that over here. A little bit of oil still around there doesn't really matter. I'm just trying to get the more waxy consistency out. Now the brown shadow here, I'll be using a lot already, so most of the oil's already been poured out. So the consistency is pretty nice already. You can also use cardboard for this, but I find paper towel works a lot better. So let's start by applying a highlight to the lower edges of these superstructure panels in the front here. So I take some light buff and apply just a fairly general amount along the edge here, because I want a slightly lighter color at the bottom of these panels compared to the top. This is a little bit like doing color modulation during the airbrushing stage. But what I'm doing now I find has much more control because you can do it carefully with a bunch of layers of oil paint. You can of course wipe it away immediately if you don't like the effect with some thinner. I find that airbrushing this using some color modulation techniques, you have a lot less control. So I like to use a little bit of thinner if I have to, but of course if I don't need to I'll just blend it in dry just using the brush itself. But getting a tiny bit on the brush of enamel thinner can help you do the blending process a little quicker. So as you can see right now, it doesn't really look that nice, so I have to keep on blending. Might take a minute or so, but eventually you'll get to this one point where you realize it looks great, and then you don't want to touch it anymore. So here I'm doing side-to-side motions. Some people might not like that because they think, oh, it's not going to look like rain streaks, but I'm just trying to spread it out. And then at the end here, I do some up and down motions. But really, it's just a very faint effect, so it doesn't really matter. You're not going to really get any streaks going with this. This side's now been drying for about a minute here because I was working the opposite end, so I go back in there and streak it back and forth a little more. Really just trying to spread and blend this out until it gets to that one point where I realize, oh, it looks great. And you can't really notice any obvious lines or anything like that. It's just a very subtle gradient from low to high. And hopefully you can see that there's a little bit of lighter color at the lower end of these panels than there is at the top. Now here I'm bringing in a little bit of the dark yellow color to make this panel a little darker, I guess you could say. It's not really much darker, it's really just like a slightly discolored effect. So I'm doing highlighting, shadows, discoloration, really just adding different tones to the tank with these oil paints here. So here, get a little more of the light buff color on the edge of this panel here to highlight it a little bit. Make sure it looks unified with the rest of the tank. So on the edge here, I've mixed about a 50-50 mix of the brown shadow and dark yellow colors. And I'm just brushing it in there to make a little bit of a darker effect around these details. And I use a little bit of thinner to wipe off the accidental application into the top there. And then I get a little bit of light buff color, which I used to highlight that panel already, and blend it in. This effect is all about blending back and forth, layer upon layer. I don't let things dry. I just do one panel, move on next one. If I mess up a little bit and work accidentally back over to the top of the panel, I just go back and forth and apply more layers. So I grab a little more of that brown and yellow mix and apply it around the details here for a little more shadow effect, and then I start to stipple it around and blend it in. I'm not using any thinner, I'm just kind of wiping it around because these oil paints take a long time to dry, at least a couple of hours, and they don't really adhere to the model well until they're completely dry, so you have a long period to work with them. You don't really need any thinner. So I use a little bit right there just to blend that around a little bit. Then I get some light buff color and a hint of dark yellow and highlight this panel, which also kind of blends in the rest of these darker effects I applied. Now here I'm doing a little bit of a scooping action where I'm kind of removing paint from the model because there's a little too much darkness around that shield there, so I scoop some off and then I start to do a little more blending here obviously. Apply a little more highlight, then just wipe it around, gently blend it back and forth. This isn't sped up very much, just me quickly wiping it back and forth, trying to blend this out until it gets to that point where it's just gentle transitions between highlight and shadow. Now over here I apply some dark yellow color, and then I realize that's not dark enough, so I apply a couple of dollops of brown shadow, kind of mix them on the model like that, and then it's about a 50-50 mix, I guess you could say. Very, very generous amounts of the light buff on the edge there, and then I start to blend it. The big flat brush here just helps me do this quicker because this is a nice big flat panel. So I just kind of work it back and forth, do stippling, streaking, kind of just all the motions I can to make sure there's no uniform direction or any really lines left. I want it to be very, very subtle. A slight gradient between lighter on the outside and darker towards the inside of that panel. So I applied a couple of dots of dark yellow here and did kind of like a dot filter effect, you could say, because I wanted a little bit of streaking discoloration on this panel here, but I didn't really want to really discolor it very much because it's still a highlight. It's up on the top here. On the engine deck here, similar effects to what I was doing on the roof of the superstructure, applying a little bit of dark yellow around the outside of these panels here to give them a little bit of a difference in color to the rest of the engine deck. Remember, if I can, I'm not using any thinner. I'm just letting the brush move the paint around the surface of the tank. And there has been no gloss coat or anything like that. It's pretty satin or matte from the base coat application. So a little bit of highlighting here with some light buff on the 5 upper engine deck panels. I did this over the whole tank, just thinking about how some areas would see more light than others, some areas would see more shadow, some areas would be a little more discolored, just thinking about how I can make this tank look cool. As you can see, it has a nice effect. Some areas look lighter, some areas darker, some areas have a gradient between light and dark, and just looks nice. It took probably about 6 hours total, but I like this effect a lot. It's a slow, methodical process, and I find it to be really fun and relaxing. The next step in the weathering process is to chip the tank. I'm doing some two-tone chipping here using brush and sponge techniques. Two-tone chipping involves first doing some lighter chipping effects and then afterwards going in with a darker color and adding some depth to them. I'm using AK723 Dust as the main color for the lighter chips. I think this color is already perfect already, and these AK paints don't need to be thinned at all out of the jar. So I use a little bit of my brush here. Very small brush, and then I'm also brushing off even more because I want only a small amount at once. If you apply too much at once, the chips will end up being these round spherical shapes rather than these gentle, random, chippy effects. I'm not trying to actually paint the chipping shapes onto the tank, I'm just letting the bristles and the brush make it itself when I actually just do some gentle stippling on the tank. When using acrylics, every once in a while here I'm just wiping off my brush with a little bit of water because acrylics will dry pretty fast in the bristles of the brush and make it frayed and ruined. When doing the chipping like this, I keep most of it towards the edges and exposed surfaces like that where the crew would most likely walk around, drag ammo boxes up over the tank, things like that, but I do a couple of chips on the flat panels themselves on areas where I know that the crew would walk around the most. Of course, hatches like this probably see the most use in the entire tank, so I made sure to heavily chip them around the edges. Again, exposed edges like this would see lots of use if there's anything on the engine deck, like stowage that's banging around when the tank's moving. These areas will get kicked up by the crew also when they're walking around, so I chipped up the edges here pretty heavily. Similarly, I chipped the engine deck hatches as well as the upper superstructure hatches because those would also see lots of use if the crew is ever entering the tank or fixing the engine or anything like that. On the exposed sides of these radio box sponsons, I figured that if the tank ever goes through any bushes or trees or anything like that, these are probably going to get scraped up a little bit by any branches, so I did some very gentle scraping effects along them with a very small brush and a very small amount of paint. Here we're going to do some sponge chipping on the fenders. I'm using a pair of self-closing pliers and a small piece of foam sponge. I tear off a little piece of the foam sponge and hold in the pliers. The ragged torn edge of the sponge has a very nice texture to it, which will make some realistic chipping effects on our tank. Much like the previous chipping effects, this is very easy to overdo. so I'm using only a very, very small amount of paint on the sponge. As you can see, I'm wiping off most of it on the paper towel here before I gently and carefully apply it to the model. It's a good idea to keep rotating the piece of sponge around, otherwise you'll get the same chipping pattern in the same area over and over again. I chose the sponge chipping technique on this area of the tank because I wanted just general wear and tear rather than more specific chipping effects, though of course you can always use this over the rest of the tank as well if that's more what you're aiming for. To make the darker tone for the two-tone chips, I mixed up about a 50-50 mix of Tamiya XF7 Flat Red and XF72 Japan Ground Self-Defense Force Brown. I'm mixing the color to see if it looks nice. It was about a half and half mix, not exact, none of my colors really are, I just do it by eye. Here I test the consistency, it's a little thick so I add 2 drops of water and mix it up a little more and test it, see if it's nice. As with the previous chipping, it's very easy to overdo this effect. I'm adding this only to the centers of the largest chips, leaving of course the exposed lighter color around the edges. This medium red-brown color mimics exposed primer, as well as adding some depth to the heaviest areas of chipping on the tank. I added depth to these marks in the superstructure exterior by applying a little more red-brown color to the middle of these scrapes. I was holding the tank at an awkward angle here to film it, so the scrapes weren't very straight. So afterwards I go in with a little bit of lacquer thinner on my brush, a very, very small amount, and gently clean them up when they're still wet. Here I have my brush very, very lightly damp with some lacquer thinner, and I'm gently working at the top of that scrape there to straighten it up. Of course, if I apply too much pressure here, I'll start to remove the base coat of the tank, which is not good at all, so I'm being very, very careful. And now I'm just adding a little more depth to some of these chips, where I think the crew to walk around the tank the most. The chipping effects are now complete in the tank. It's a little heavier than I probably would do in a normal tank, but since there was going to be a whitewash supply over top of this, I went a little more extreme so it would be visible through the whitewash at the end. I'm happy with how it came out though, the tank definitely looks like it's seen some action. Let's move on to detail painting. Here I'm going to do all the tools and other accessories on the tank using a bunch of paints. I began by painting all the metal areas of the tank using AK720 rubber tires. This was the tow cables and all the tools and stuff like that. I know it's rubber tires, but it looks like a nice muted gray, brown, black metal color. In general, I like how it looks. I also think these AK paints brush really well right out of the jar, so I usually use them for detail painting like this. One thing a lot of people miss is the fact that the tow cable itself actually wraps around the outside of these little eyelets at the end, so I make sure to paint these the same color as the rest of the tow cable. I do a little bit of a sloppy job here because it's an awkward angle to film it, so I go in there with a little bit of lacquer thinner and kind of clean it up a little bit later. But I'm just trying to show here that these are actually part of the cable themselves as well. I painted the antenna on the StuG with the same rubber tires color, which I guess makes sense because these are probably rubberized in real life. And honestly, these probably would remain the base color of the tank, but I just kind of want to emphasize the fact that they're there and they look kind of cool, so I painted them black and later kind of faded in with the whitewash. Still using the AK720 rubber tires, I began by doing some metallic chipping on the tools. Now, I'm one of those guys who believes that the tools were painted the same color as the tank, as usually they were stuck on the tank in the factory and then it was painted, everything like that. So I like to chip them instead heavily with a metallic color to make it look like they've been used, and of course make them look like they're a different addition to the tank, but still painted in the same base color. So I'm just kind of like stippling this on, same kind of motion I was doing earlier with the chipping on the tank, but I'm just kind of like carefully applying this, and I can even do a little bit of scrubbing right after I apply it, which kind of works away the paint, makes it even more chipped. So the metallic chipping was applied to the shovel, the axe, the S-hooks, the sledgehammer, and the jack. Here I'm showing the jack. So it's chipped up pretty heavily. I figured that these things would get worn when they're in use, and also because they're kind of attached inside the tank, so they're going to get kicked up and beaten around like everything else. Acrylic paints dry pretty quick, but if you apply a little too much, like I do right here, I get my brush wet quickly with a little bit of water, and then I quickly scrub out like this. I have maybe about 15 seconds to do this, but it kind of further emphasizes the chipping effect because you're literally chipping at the chips you just applied, so it's pretty useful in certain cases. The handle of the jack I figured would be used pretty frequently. Same thing with the edges of it, probably get beat up when it's used. And then the actual clasps that mounted to the tank were previously chipped as the same color as the tank, with that light two-tone chipping I did with the light color and the dark color. So it's kind of a little bit of contrast here between the gray metallic color I'm using here and then the lighter color and darker color of the chipping on the tank. Of course, this gray color isn't really that metallic, it's not really shiny, but I like the matte iron look of it. For the areas of wood on the tank, I'm using Panzerace's 310 Old Wood by Vallejo. Similar with the metallic chips, I'm not really painting the handles this color, I'm really just chipping at them, where I think the crew would hold the most, so kind of at the end and about halfway down, and also just kind of generic chips where they would get kicked around the vehicle. This color is really light, it's barely darker than the base color of the tank, but as Adam Mann showed me, this is the color of German wooden tools. So the only wooden things in the tank are the axe, sledgehammer, and shovel handles, as well as the jack block here. Now for the jack block, it's just a big piece of wood really on the outside, so I'm really just kind of painting it along. Went pretty heavy with the chipping, you could say here, but I'm just trying to emphasize the fact that it's wood and it's pretty interesting and exposed here. Now for a second layer of wooden chipping using AK-754 Dunkel Brown. Here I'm not really trying to do like a two-tone effect I did previously on the tank, I'm just trying to make a second layer of chipping. So I'm not going over only the insides of the lighter chipped areas, I'm doing also chipping areas of just this color on top of them, on top of the base color, just really everywhere, and just also letting the molded wooden texture of this part take the paint, just make it look nice and wooden. Remember, I'm not really trying to paint chipping shapes on there, I'm kind of dry brushing, stippling, rolling the bristles around, allowing the brush to make the shapes for me. This style of rear light should be painted a dark blue color. The kit comes with a clear part that I hadn't added before this point. I used Panzerace's 309 periscopes for this, which I usually use for periscopes, but it was a nice dark blue color and I figured it was close enough. Apparently this should be a little darker in real life, because at daytime this would be basically black looking. But I like the color of a blue light on a yellow tank, kind of makes some emphasis there and some contrast, so I kept this color the way it was. Panzerace's colors can be a little thick from the jar, so I thin them a little with water usually, but not very much. I applied the clear part and secured it with one small drop of Tamiya Extra Thin Cement. It came out quite well. Now for the wire cutters. I begin with AK717 Rot Brown. I apply it as a very thin filter-like consistency at first, and then I start to apply some kind of heavier splotches later. I'm kind of doing a chipping effect here. These are made of compressed paper that was dyed red, apparently, so I'm kind of trying to emphasize that here with this Rot Brown color. And I do a little bit of chipping with XF55 Deck Tan by Tamiya, which is a nice light concrete-y color. I don't know why I really did this, it just looks cool. Though those ends there should be black, not XF55 like I just painted them. This is just supposed to be like a highlight to the chips on the inside of them, similar to two-tone chipping. Because of the heat shield and lower engine deck area on the StuG here, the exhausts are completely invisible from the rear. They're located right here and here, and usually you can see them on a Panzer III, but on the StuG here you cannot. Therefore, I didn't bother rusting them up, but if I were to, I'd use a dark brown pigment as a base color, then do an overall dusting of a light rust color, then some very, very light yellow rust as a highlight in some areas. And with that, the detail painting is complete on the tank. This has really unified the tools and everything else with the rest of the tank, as they all look nicely chipped up and weathered together. The overall surface weathering of the tank is pretty much complete. All it's up to do now is to seal it up and do the whitewash and then the mud. At this point, I gave the model the only sealing coat I ever did, which was two thin coats of Tester's Dull Coat. Then I began the application of the whitewash. For this, I used AK751 washable white paint. Even though the previous weathering had been thoroughly sealed by the dull coat, I was still very careful with how I applied the whitewash. I wanted this to be very faint, and I didn't want to cover up the weathering effects I'd already done. Therefore, I only did one area at a time. I would carefully apply one very thin coat to a small area of the tank, such as the side of the upper superstructure here, and then immediately start to chip at it. With the paint having dried for maybe 3 minutes at most, I quickly take an old scruffy brush, wet it with water a little bit, and begin the chipping process. I'm carefully applying small amounts of water to the tank and then kind of rubbing around at it, mimicking the chipping effects that I believe would occur here. So here, for example, I was already doing the horizontal scraping effects on the hull with the chipping, so I'm mimicking that here with a whitewash. In other areas where I did heavy chipping on the upper surface of the tank where I think the crew would walk around most, those areas also received lots of chipping on the whitewash. I was being really careful with how I applied the whitewash, so in some areas I did a very thin coat, chipped it, and then let that dry for about an hour as I worked on other areas, and then I would actually apply another coat on top of the area I'd previously done, and then chip it again, and this just adds more layers to the chipping effect and looks pretty realistic, as well as being like a more careful process because of course you're not going to overdo it because you're doing very thin coats and you have lots of control with what the chips are like and how opaque the layer is. The AK Interactive Washable White Paint product is a very unique acrylic paint in the fact that it chips properly for skin modeling when you apply a little bit of water to it. Therefore, it's very similar to the hairspray technique, but it's a one-step process as the chipping fluid is integrated into the white paint. Therefore, you just need to apply a thin coat of it, let it dry for about 5-10 minutes, and then you can just start to chip at it right away with a little bit of water. I really like the resulting chipping effects. They're very similar to those you can achieve with the hairspray technique, but this product is a little bit unique in the fact that, as well as chipping, it also kind of reactivates, so that way you can build up heavier areas to make it look like the paint's been applied unevenly by the crew, as they often did this with a mop or something in the field. I can never really get this product to spray very smoothly, no matter how much I thin it. Since I'm not sure what to thin it with, because I'm kind of nervous about trying proper thinner since it's supposed to be a chippable product, I don't want to really modify it in any way, the chemical composition, so I'm only ever using water to thin it, and I use 2 drops of water for every 3 drops of paint, which is the best ratio I can find. But still, it doesn't spray that smoothly. You get little specks in some of the areas where you do a more opaque layer, kind of doesn't go down very smoothly. But that doesn't really matter since I'm doing all the heavy chipping here, so most of those little specks get worn away. The rest of them look like little chipped areas. And on the flatter areas, I kind of rub over those with a big flat brush, so they all get blended down and it really just blends in with the chipping effect. Which, as you can see, I'm keeping mainly around the edges of panels, like I was doing earlier with the two-tone chipping, because those areas get worn down the most. and with that we've completed the application of the whitewash camouflage to the tank. It looks pretty nice, but I want to go back with a little bit of oil paint and work on some of the chipped areas to make them look a little more opaque and to improve the chipped edges. I'm using the three same colors I used previously on the highlighting and rendering effects on the tank, but I'm also adding winter white, which is just a flat white color, as well as dark mud, which is a dark green-brown. The closest standard artist oil colors I can come up with are titanium white, Naples yellow, yellow ochre, raw umber, and burnt umber. What I'm trying to do is modify the chipping pattern that I've achieved on the whitewash in certain areas, and also add more opaque areas. Here I'm modifying the chipping edge, so I apply a little bit of the white oil paint, then I blend it in one direction towards the rest of the camouflage pattern. Makes it look like there's a sharper edge there, and actually blends in nicely with the rest of the white. Lower down, I'm just trying to achieve more opaque areas, so I'm just blending these in randomly. This is very similar to the oil rendering effects I was doing earlier, where I added some highlights and lowlights and discoloration to the panels of the tank. And remember, if I can, I'm not using any thinner at all. I'm just blending the paints in dry. On the surface here on the top, I'm just trying to achieve some almost highlight effects on the edge of the chipping, so I'm stippling on a very, very small amount of white oil paint here. This really emphasizes the chipping and makes it have a little more depth. Here I figured the whitewash wouldn't really get worn away on the inside of this crevice, so I applied small amounts of whitewash to the edge there, being careful not to overdo the darkening effect I've already achieved with the pin wash. As you can tell here, this has had a nice effect on the whitewash. There are more opaque areas and more defined chipped edges. I'm especially pleased with how it came out on the engine deck here. Now for some oil rendering. This is to emphasize the chipped edges and also bring some of the base yellow back through the winter camouflage. Here I'm using a small amount of brown oil paint to further darken up the edge of this chipped area. This is a very similar effect to the pin wash in the fact that it makes a fake shadow. Using a small amount of white oil paint, I begin to redefine the edges of the winter camouflage. Next, I use a small amount of thinner to carefully blend these chips in with the rest of the whitewash. And then I apply some heavier areas of white oil paint here and repeat the process, carefully blending it in with a little bit of thinner, and this is just to map in heavier areas of the whitewash. For this technique, I mainly use the brown oil paints, such as the brown shadow as well as the dark mud, which is slightly greenish, because I want to achieve similar colors to those I'd already done with the other darkening effects, for example the pin wash. Therefore, I kept these techniques around the areas that already had these darkening effects, so mainly you can see here areas close to the pin wash so I can kind of blend the darkening effects up the sides, also creating some kind of contrast and emphasis on the areas of chipping and the whitewash, though in some areas like here, I did use a little bit of yellow to simulate the yellow base color showing back through the areas of whitewash camouflage. Here, some dark brown oil paint really helps to create some contrast in these areas of chipping, and then we apply a little bit of white oil paint to build the chips back around the edges. Now, of course, this is not a necessary technique, it's very stylistic and subtle, but I find that oil paints can create some very cool effects like this. Add a little bit of interest to the winter camouflage pattern. With the whitewash complete, let's move on to the mud effects. Here I'm using some dark Russian textured earth, a couple of contrasting nitriline earth effects, and a dark brown, medium brown, and light brown pigment. I had planned to do some very heavy mud effects on this tank, so I began by applying a fairly heavy coat of this dark Russian textured earth by Wilder. My intention here is to merely begin the process of the mud and earth buildups. So this isn't going to be the final color or anything like that, it's just to provide the initial mass and accumulations of earth and mud on the lower surface of the tank. So I'm applying this around the details, mainly keeping towards the tops of them where most mud would fall from the tracks above, and also keeping in mind that these torsion arms will swing up and down, so most mud around them will be knocked away. We're going to apply other colors and pigments and products on top of this later. Right now the color is a little green-brown. It's a lot more brown than it looks when it dries, and the jar looks pretty green. But again, this isn't really the final color. As this is an acrylic product, you can actually thin it down with water. So here I got a little bit of water on my brush, and I'm just trying to blend in the transitions to make them a little more smooth. Of course, the application of the pigments later does provide a much better blending effect than this does. This is just to merely kind of smooth out the transition of the actual accumulations of mud here, because I don't want an awkward edge where it begins. Here you can see how the application of the textured earth has had a nice effect, building up an initial layer of earth that we can now modify with some pigments and nitriline effects. Here I have two nitriline effects, one of which is the dark road clay effect, which is kind of greenish almost, and then I have the light brown dirt effect, which is a little more red. And then I have the two dark brown colors here, one of which is a little more gray. And really I'm just trying to achieve a random layering of all the products here. So we'll apply one of the nitriline effects, and then some pigment over it, then another of the nitriline effects, and then the same pigment or another pigment. And I'm just doing layering here, mixing all these different tones together, and not letting anything dry. Really, I'm just trying to get variances in the color here, so you'll have some areas look a little more light, some a little more dark, some maybe wet, some maybe dry, and the result is a very nice, modulated, realistic-looking earth effect on the lower areas of the tank. To tie the lighter upper hull color in with the darker dirt effects lower down, I applied a little bit of the dry Russian clay pigment to the center of the front and rear of the lower hull here, where I figured that the least wet mud spatter would occur. This is to simulate some drier mud effects in the center here that's kind of isolated from the wheels and tracks on the tank. So I'm just dusting around with a brush and blending it in gently. To further blend in this effect, I'm doing some speckling techniques. I take a little bit of light brown dirt effect that I was using previously on the lower hull for the mud effects. Then I just kind of flick at my brush like this. As you can see, the paint flies off the bristles. I mask off the engine deck here with a piece of paper towel because these specks can go very, very far. And then I just carefully flick at the brush here, and this helps to blend in the dusty effect with the darker effects lower down. To continue the weathering on the sides of the hull, I began by first stippling on the same two brown pigments I was using on the rear, which are brown Russian earth and dark brown. These were applied quite randomly over the area that was the transition zone between the textured earth and the lower hull color. Next, I did some downward streaking effects just by applying the same nitriline effects from earlier, which are the light brown dirt effect and the dark road clay effect. As you can see, I'm just kind of applying both back and forth in this vertical streaking motion. This helps to bind on the pigments I just applied, and also mimics the mud or water flowing down from the tracks as they roll over the top rung. Next, I applied the same pigments as earlier, but this time keeping them more around the lower areas where I figured that the mud would accumulate most. And then I kind of fixed them on by applying some small areas of those same nitriline effects as earlier. Here you can see I'm applying the kind of greenish one, which is the dark road clay effect. And now I apply the slightly reddish one, which is the light brown dirt effect. And these two colors here, along with the two colors of pigment I was applying, helped to make some modulation in the muddy areas and just make it look a little more interesting. This is all layering back and forth. You can see I apply some nitriline effect and then some pigment. Kind of stippling around, and then I apply a little more pigment here. Then some more nitriline effect. Again, not letting these dry, I'm just kind of blending them all back together. Then some more natural line effects here, some pigments, and then more natural line. I find the fenders to be often a little bit of a weird spot to weather because they're kind of a transition zone between the lower hull area, which is often quite dark with the mud effects, and the upper hull area, which on this tank is fairly light. So I carefully stippled on some of the same dark brown pigments I was using on the lower hull over the fenders here, keeping this effect very light and more towards the crevices near these fender support arms. This is the result of the mud effects we did on the lower areas of the tank. As you can see, we have some areas look a little more wet, some areas look a little more dry, we also have some vertical streaks on the sides, and some spatter effects on the front and rear. For the mud effects on the wheels, I used the same technique as I had in the lower areas of the tank. First, I applied both the natural light effects, which were the, again, light brown dirt effect and dark road clay effect, and then I stippled on some of the same pigments, which were brown Russian earth and dark brown. I try to get most of the pigments around the crevices here because I figured that's where most of the mud would build up and remain. As the wheel spins around, I figured a bunch of it would fall off and not really stick on the flat surfaces very much, so I didn't use any textured earth or anything like that here. I'm just letting the pigments make a very thin layer of mud on this area. On the idler wheel, I use the exact same process. I've waited for the mud effects to dry, and I'm using some pigments here to kind of blend everything in a little better. As you can see, I'm just applying small amounts by brush, and if I apply a little too much, I can blow off the excess like this. I use the pigments to further blend in the areas of whitewash with the darker areas of mud effect on the wheel here. For this very reason, I used the dry Russian clay pigment because I needed something a little bit lighter to kind of have a nice transition between the darker brown pigments and then the lighter colors of whitewash in the drive sprocket. The last step was to set in the pigments using a little bit of enamel thinner here. I'm just carefully applying it around the edges because I don't want to really wash away the pigments. And I'm letting it flow around on the wheel, absorb the pigments, and then when it dries, it'll help hold them on a little better. For the road wheels, I did a similar effect where I first applied some of these same natural line effects once again. Both effects, back and forth, layering, not letting them dry. Just mixing, getting some different tones in every single wheel because I want a little bit of contrast and difference. Some wheels being a little more wet, some wheels looking a little more dry, and some wheels having a different color of dirt than the other ones. It all adds a little more interest to the tank. At this point, I felt I'd applied too much nitrogen effect to the tires. I kind of wanted some of the rubber to be exposed there, especially because I had done some whitewashing there and I liked the contrast between the white and black. So I just carefully kind of wipe away at it, almost scooping it off and then wiping my brush on the paper towel. But I left a little bit behind because it needed something to be able to attach the pigments onto later. The next step was to apply some dark brown pigments to the wheels. As you can see, I'm kind of pouring them onto the tank by lightly tapping my finger against the brush, which makes the pigments fall off. This allows me to preserve the texture of the pigments, because if I just kind of put them on by actually like almost painting them or stippling them, they're gonna kind of melt down into the wet and natural line effects that are already on the wheels. And then now I do the stippling. This is just to kind of push them onto the enamel product that it's been applied beforehand and helps to bind them in and also spread them out a little bit. But by applying the pigments like this and then stippling, rather than just applying them by stippling, it maintains more of the texture and separation I've achieved with some of the little areas of dirt on the wheels. And then I use a little bit of enamel thinner here to kind of clean up the hubs or some areas where I want some more of the yellow base color of the wheel to be exposed. The mud effects on the wheels are complete. Compared to the hull, there's much less mud here since the wheels are constantly in motion and therefore most of the mud gets kicked off. The final step in this video is to paint and weather the tracks. As you can see, there are the full length tracks which go around the wheels, as well as some shorter lengths of spare track which we will look at first. My method for weathering the spare tracks involves only a couple of products. The first step is to paint them with a base coat of Tamiya XF69 NATO Black. I make sure to thoroughly cover the tracks here, since the pigments we apply later are not very opaque, and won't cover up any gaps in the paintwork. Now I stipulate a coat of this brown Russian earth pigment over the entire surface of the tracks here. I like the slightly grayish hue to this pigment. It has a nice effect and it looks like a slightly oxidized or just kind of like faded dark brown gray color. Now I do some very, very small applications of red rust to some areas of the spare tracks here. Picking out individual links and kind of giving them a little bit of a reddish hue, kind of add some contrast between the individual links, also kind of hints at a small amount of rust, though these tracks didn't really get that rusty in real life, so I tried to keep it really refined. The other length of the spare track were done the exact same way. Here I'm just scooping off extra pigment on the paper towel here because I'm just trying to recycle some of it. For a little bit of contrast, I add the red rust only to the right track piece here, but again it's just a very, very small amount. I didn't put any whitewash on these spare track links here because I figured that they would kind of bring some darker colors to the upper surface of the tank, which echoes the mud effects on the lower areas. For the full track links, I used some Tamiya paint to give them a base coat, and then I did the exact same mud effects that I had on the road wheels. I gave the tracks a base coat of Tamiya XF72 Japan Ground Self-Defense Force Brown. I always paint my tracks with this color because it's a nice gray-brown color. I think it looks really realistic and a nice base for the mud effects later. After this had dried, I dry brushed the tracks with Tamiya XF55 Deck Tan. This is to give a highlight to the tracks. I'm not really aiming for anything metallic here, just a lighter, dirty, dusty color. I'm not much of a fan of metallic paints and pigments, so I like to keep my products pretty matte looking, so that's why I'm using just a normal gray beige color here for the dry brushing. But this does really make the details pop on the tracks. The mud effects on the tracks were done the exact same way as I did on the road wheels. First I applied some random amounts of these two Nudgeline effects here. Again, one's a little more green, one's a little more red. And I just apply a very heavy coat over the entire thing, mixing both of them back and forth and also kind of mixing them on the model. Not really caring if I put some of the color in the same spot as the other one because it's really just a very faint base effect that really only serves to bind on the pigments later, but also does a little bit of modulation. In the same way I did the mud effects on the row wheels, I'm carefully tapping my finger against the brush here to gently sprinkle some pigment over the surface of the tracks. The pigments adhere pretty well to the wet Nudgeline effects on the tracks already. Using a small flat brush and some stippling motions, I carefully blend the pigments into the wet Nudgeline effects. All the different products I used for the mud effects here gave me a nice modulated mud effect. As you can see, some areas look a little more wet and some look a little more dry. With the gyre sprocket and road wheels attached, I carefully slid the top length of track into place. Once I liked how it was positioned, I carefully put on the idler wheel here to secure things and wrap the track around it. And I carefully just had to kind of fiddle things around here until everything lined up properly. I used a couple of sticks and some paint brushes to kind of wedge things together at the top, and then some Tamiya Extra Thin glued everything together. After all that handling to get everything lined up, I had to do a couple of touch-ups to the lower areas of the tank here, so I'm just using some of the pigments I was using earlier. I'm just dusting over some fingerprints and stuff like that I didn't like. The final touch was to add some soot effects to the muzzle brake here. This is something you often see in reference photos, but in my opinion people often overdo this by heavily darkening this entire area. So I kept the black pigment around only the little exhaust ports here where I figured most of the exhaust would come from. For the first time I'd ever tried this with pigments, I was actually really happy with the effect I achieved here on the muzzle brake. With everything installed on the tank, you can see how the mud effects we've achieved on the wheels and tracks are unified with those of the lower hull. The darker color here really looks like winter mud, and I'm also very pleased with the amount of mud that there is on the tank. It doesn't look overdone at all, considering what I've seen in reference photos here. This completes the weathering of the tank. In this video, I mentioned the word unity a lot. By unity, I mean I want all the tones of the tank to look like they work well together. So the upper surface of the tank, I want it to look like it matches the lower surface of the tank. Because of this, I did some dusty effects lower down, as well as leaving some whitewash on the wheels, which mimics the lighter colors up at the top of the tank. And of course, the darker colors of the spare tracks, some of the chipping of the tools, as well as the antenna, mimics the muddy effects lower down. Therefore, the tones overall are really well unified, and the tank does look like it works well together. The final result was better than I expected, honestly. I didn't plan for anything this good to be coming out in this video, so I'm very happy with it. I'm especially pleased with how I did the whitewash because I didn't want to cover up the previous weathering effects very heavily, and I think I did that very well. Also, the mud effects, as you know, I did a very nice job on them, I think, so I'm very happy with how I did it on this model. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I hope you learned something new and are inspired to try something like this on your model. Of course, thank you very much for watching as always. This is Panzerice36, and I will see you in the next video. Goodbye.